At first it was 27 days. That was the record we were going for, and I thought I could do it, but I wasn't sure. Then we got going, it turned into 21 days. That was different. That was more than just a bike ride.
That was bike ride and preparation.
I had the bike ride, but no preparation. Too disjointed. You see what it's like being inside my head. I do the writing, I do the blogs, and the bike riding. I never thought about the border post. They kept me waiting for hours at a time. Think about it. I lost a day writing, a day blogging, I lost a day filming, and I lost a day at Bogota Airport. I tried really hard to catch up, do you know, and I nearly did, and I would only be 3 hours behind. I might have even got it. But coming second isn't any use to me. Already got a new plan. It's unbelievable. New idea, new plan. You'll love it. Best journey I've ever done.
Walking out of the terminal, I hit a wall of heat that takes your breath away. It was 50 degrees and 100 degrees humidity, enough to stop an elephant in its tracks, and I was faced with a non-stop journey of almost 2,000 miles to Singapore. My passage through customs had been smooth thanks to a welcome contact in Thailand. It couldn't have been easier. Bangkok is notorious for its appalling traffic pollution, and as I set off through the city, the diesel and petrol fumes were almost overwhelming. The sooner I got through Bangkok, the better. Then I could head south into the clean night air. Singapore is connected by a single road rail causeway with customs points at each end. I met up with another film crew to make the next video report in no man's land between the two countries.
I'm actually on the causeway going into Singapore. And one of the strange things about Malaysia was that I didn't see it. I had to travel through Malaysia, through the night, in order to get to Singapore and get my bike freighted from Singapore Airport.
Out of Singapore customs and into my 14th country of the trip, I headed for the city with its New York-style skyscrapers and busy streets. Traffic pollution is strictly regulated here. You can't own a car that's more than 10 years old. And they're all shipped to poorer neighbouring countries. Taxis and lorries are pollution checked every year. Another press call, this time for Mobil, then on past the financial centre where the infamous trader Nick Leeson used to work. Out to the airport to a luxurious hotel. A thank you for my sponsors.
Ice Cut, Gobbler's Knob, Oil Spill Hill, Chicken Run and Beaver Slide, they're all part of the historic legend of the Ice Road Truckers. I'd imagine how riding across frozen lakes might concentrate the mind. The reality had been worse. It had been cold and the rain had stung my face. The road was slippery, no other traffic, and I'd been alone. Already this Arctic landscape was a memory. The lakes were still and the unmoving leaves of the tundra had not forget. But what had cemented my knowledge of being far away from anywhere was the silence. The journey to become the fastest man around the world had begun.
It gives the impression of what it's like to be an incredible celebrity.
I think I've ridden about seven hours. So that is putting me, if I go for another 6 hours, then another 6 hours, that's 18 hours, I would be on a 1,200 mile day. My core temperature was just exploding. My face went bright red and I was in a bad way. And it took me nearly 3 hours to get the temperature back down.
Don't know where I am now, but I know I'm on the way to Dawson Creek or Fort Nelson or somewhere, but I've been riding for about 30 odd hours. And I think if I get to Dawson Creek by midnight, I'll have done 2,000 miles in something like 33 or 34 hours. I think as an endurance bike rider, as an extreme endurance bike rider, one of my gifts is to be able to sleep anywhere really at a moment's notice. I can go to sleep in an instant and I can wake up very quickly. And you know, as long as I want to, I'm bright as a button straight away. And I can exist on 1 or 2 hours a night for days and days and days. So I don't need to ride very fast during the day to get a great mileage up over a 24 hour period. You know, I can sleep standing up, I can sleep on my bike, I can sleep against a fence on the floor, I can sleep in an alien environment, I can sleep during the day, in the middle of the night. It doesn't matter where it is. I think it's just one of the things that makes me tick.
For me, Timbuktu has been a name, a destination. It's one of these names that evokes feelings. It's not just a place. It creates a picture, an image in my head of the great places, say, on the likes of the Silk Road and the Spice Route and things like that.
Yesterday was a brilliant ride. I really enjoyed that. It's one of those rides that will stick in my mind for years.
Timbuktu has a name along there with Samarkand and Tashkent for me.
You know, you are doing something that I think the majority of these people have looked to do at some point in their life. You know, I mean, we haven't known it's going to be Timbuktu, but there's a big ride in everybody, isn't there?
To be within 100 or so miles of it, it's going to be superb.
Well, you know, thanks to yourself, you bring it out. You let us do it, don't you? You know, and for that, I'm grateful because this has been the ride of a lifetime, mate.
Thank you. I've actually gone from here all the way up here, wiggled up South America and Central America and North America up to the top, and then I've gone back all the way again to the very bottom.
I sold you a bear tooth that I got off of a 500-pound black bear down the Ray River.
The road surface is now treacherous. One fall, and I'd have to maybe ride with a broken arm. Miles on day one through hard gravel and bitterly cold rain. 842 miles on day two. I am 150 miles down on my best schedule,